One of the biggest mysteries of the Bible is what on earth happened to the 10 lost tribes of Israel? Where did they go? Why can't we find them? Did they just disappear and vanish into thin air, never to be seen again? Well, modern archaeology and history can tell you all about the ancient civilizations and even those that existed around the lost tribes. The Romans, the Greeks, the Persians, the Assyrians, the Babylonians, but not those lost tribes. Could there be a conspiracy, an effort to cover up, to hide the truth of the true identity of those of the lost tribes? Well, let us begin with the Bible. We learn in the Book of Kings that 10 of the tribes of Israel were taken into captivity by the Assyrians, never to return again, and later on the remaining two tribes, Judah and Benjamin, by the Babylonians. So by the time Christ came 600 years later, only a small remnant had returned from Babylon, now living amongst a whole mixed multitude of people in the province known simply as Judea, which was now ruled over by the Romans. Now most people believe that the scattering began during the deportations. However, in truth, it was already happening in the time of the 12 patriarchs. Not all Israelites remained with their brethren. Many deserted and chose to go their own way, but this was all part of Yahweh's plan, as he had promised to scatter Israel amongst all the nations and eventually to replace those very nations. In Greek literature, Dardanos is the legendary founder of Troy, whilst his brother Calchas founded the city of Thebes. In Chronicles, these two brothers are listed as the sons of Zerah, the sons of Judah. Now, since kings were to come out of Judah, this all makes sense. The Pharaoh's line of kings was to rule over Israel, whilst the Zara line of kings were to rule over Europe. And if we look on a map, we can easily see how during the Exodus, instead of going to Israel, sailing to Greece is certainly not too far away from the shores of Egypt. One Greek historian, Diodorus Siculus, confirms this, quoting an earlier historian, Hecatius. Now, he gave a strange account of the Israelite Exodus, more from an Egyptian viewpoint, that some came to Greece, chief among them Danaus and Cadmus, whilst the majority were headed by a man called Moses, outstanding for both his wisdom and for his courage. So we can see that the Greeks had records of Israelites settling in Greece, and certainly not every Israelite followed Moses. As for Danaus and Cadmus, it's easy to see, over many centuries the names got altered. Danaus is Dada, and Cadmus is Chalcol. It is no wonder then that King Solomon, only a few centuries later, was compared to these two men. In Kings 430-431, he is said to be wiser even than Chalcol and Dada. Would it not make sense that Solomon, over in Israel, would be compared to Egypt in the west, the great men of the east, and also European kings to the north? Now, around the Judges period, we begin to see the rise of another people, generally called the Phoenicians. They represented a confederation of maritime traders, rather than a defined country, and instead operated out of major port cities. They were the Israelites of the northern tribes who sailed from Tyre and Sidon. They settled not in Greece nor in Italy, but in Cyprus and the surrounding coast, slowly expanding into the Mediterranean and all the way along North Africa, forming colonies wherever they went, reaching all the way to Iberia and even as far up as the coasts of England and Ireland. Now, as for Tyre and Sidon, these cities were within the territory of the tribe of Asher for centuries during the Phoenician period, so it is obvious the Phoenicians were Israelites. Another major Israelite seaport was Dor, which was within the territory of the tribe of Manasseh. Around 1100 BC, Greece was invaded by a people called Dorians. These were Israelites from the city of Dor. The Spartans, also called Lacedaemonians, were Dorian Greeks. It is no wonder then that a letter was written between the king of Sparta and the high priest of Judea, identifying themselves as kindred from Abraham. They realized they were descendants of the Israelites. When the Phoenicians settled in Spain, back then they named it Iberia. Now this comes from the Hebrew word for Hebrew land or land of the Hebrews. The Israelites would often call themselves Hebrews. In Genesis, we learn that Abraham was referred to as Abram the Hebrew. And in the book of Jonah, even then, many, many centuries later, he refers to himself as a Hebrew. The word Hebrew comes from Eber, who was an ancestor of Abraham. Now, why would Phoenicians name a country Iberia? Well, because they were Israelites. But that's not all. The Phoenician settlers also named island Hibernia. Now, why are all these European countries being named after Hebrews? On top of that, Ireland had an ancient tribe who called themselves Tuatha De Danann, which literally means the tribe of Dan. Now, the children of Dan were prophesied in the Bible to name many places after their patriarch wherever they went. Europe is covered in rivers, cities, and even countries named after Dan. Scotland also has some interesting history. In 1320, when the Scots declared their independence in a letter to the Pope, they understood that their ancestors had come through the Pillar of Hercules, that's just under Spain, all the way from Scythia. The Scythians were the Israelites who were deported. And this shows that the Scots once understood, at least partially, their Israelite origin. What about the Romans? Where did they come from? Well, after Troy was sacked, a remnant of the Trojans, led by Aeneas, a Trojan prince, fled sailing across the Mediterranean and eventually set up a new colony in Italy. His descendants, led by Romulus, founded the city of Rome, and gradually, over many centuries, it became the great republic and empire we know of. This is confirmed by Strabo, a Greek historian, who confidently lists Romans' descent from the Trojans as a fact, even Julius Caesar being a descendant of Aeneas. And this is why, in Daniel 9:26, the Romans are referred to as the people of the prince who destroyed Jerusalem. They were Israelites. Paul also explained this in Romans 16:20, that Yahweh would soon crush Satan, or the adversary, which happened only a few years later. So we can see the Romans were largely descended from Judah, the Zara line. This is confirmed in all of Paul's epistles, with the exception of Hebrews. Where were all his epistles written to? To the nations and people in Europe. Why is that? Why only Europe? Well, is it not becoming obvious? In Romans, he explains that the Romans once knew Yahweh, but they had turned him into a corruptible image of man and beast. How can the Romans have ever known God when only Israel ever knew God? Since they were Israelites, their Zara Judah ancestors once had known Yahweh, but over the generations had corrupted the truth and essentially turned Yahweh into an idol. They left prior to the Exodus. In Corinthians, Paul explains that their fathers were with Moses in the desert, that they were under the cloud with their Israelite brethren. Again, this is only possible if their fathers were Israelites. The Corinthians were Dorian Greeks, and they left after the Exodus. In Galatians, Paul explains that the law had been our tutor for Christ. He was including the Galatians who were once under the law. They left during the Assyrian deportations. Peter's epistle only confirms all of this, stating that the Europeans are part of the dispersions. What dispersions? The Israelite dispersions. He calls them the elect, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people. He is basically repeating what Moses said to the children of Israel after the Exodus. This all shows that they are the same people. The Europeans are the Israelites. Over and over again in the Old Testament, God declares he is going to make a new covenant with the same people. For example, in Jeremiah, a new covenant specifically with Israel and Judah. And also that God will make the broken stick of Israel and Judah back into one stick again. This was accomplished when Europeans, the lost tribes, as one, accepted Christianity. And the eventual fulfillment of Christ reigning over us all as king will happen when he returns. This is also why Christ clearly explained he came only for one people. He came only for the lost sheep of Israel, and also why he commanded the apostles to only go to the lost sheep of Israel. Where did they end up going? Well, to Europe. Lastly, in Hosea, Israel collectively are described as going after their lovers, i.e. worshipping other gods, when Israel scattered all over Europe, turning to paganism, only later to return to their first husband, under Christ, who had to die so he could remarry us. So overall, we can see that white Europeans and all their offshoot nations are the lost tribes of Israel. Today, most whites have absolutely no idea who they are, but God said he would blind them. Only in the end times would they finally awaken to the full truth, and I believe we are in that time. The apostles traveled to Europe to seek their scattered Israelite brethren, our ancestors who had lost their way, forgotten where they came from and their heritage. Christianity brought all of our people back under a new covenant. It made us one people with Christ once again, our God in the flesh. You were born an Israelite, a Christian, whether you like it or not. And as Paul said, all Israel is saved, regardless of what you do or what you believe. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe. Any questions, leave them in the comments. Praise Yahweh and hail Christ, King of Kings.